Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us again here at Alpha News. Today, we're very fortunate to be joined by Rabbi Yossi Bendit, a Chabad rabbi and the executive director of the Lubavitch Heder Day School in St. Paul. Rabbi, thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me. Pleasure to be here.
So right off the bat, we're here to talk about Hanukkah and how the principles of Hanukkah sort of relate to Jewish thought more broadly. But I feel like we need to clarify for some of our viewers and frankly for me, sort of the basis of Hanukkah, because it's something that we see a lot in American culture. You see the candle holder, but not many people really know much about it.
Sure, absolutely. I agree with that. Let's start from the beginning and do a Hanukkah in a nutshell, if you will.
Absolutely.
The story takes us back close to 2,200 years ago. That was during the time that the Second Temple stood in Jerusalem, for reference. At the time, Israel was part of the Syrian Greek Empire, and although initially they had a favorable relationship and the rulers were on good terms, including Alexander the Great, who had a very positive relationship with the Jewish community in Israel, eventually it became a little bit less favorable and eventually turned hostile, in fact. The king, the monarch, who was the antagonist during the story of Hanukkah, his name is Antiochus. And without getting into too much detail, what ended up happening is that he had moved more towards introducing Hellenism, and the reason behind that, he was looking to unite his kingdom or his the people under him, the countries under him, under one kind of set of rules and cultural norms. And obviously, a prime target for that was the Jewish people, who just have a distinct way of life, a distinct religion, a credo, if you will. Mm-hmm. And what he did was introduced, Greek cultural ideas, and it was appealing to many Jewish people, and it kind of spread, and it became what we refer to as Hellenized, and he outlawed many Jewish traditions, things like learning Torah, keeping the holidays, Shabbos, Sabbath, circumcision, very basic and key tenets of Judaism, and his aim was obviously to kind of do away with the Jewish culture and have it assimilate into the Syrian Greek culture.
Were they introducing the Greek religion as well, or just the cultural stuff?
I don't know that I would say that he believed in any religion per se, more than it had infatuation with the human body. Mm-hmm. They were very into sports, very into athletic pursuits. Mm-hmm. The famous joke goes that the Greeks were into being athletic and fit, and they worshipped the human body, so we eat donuts and latkes for 8 days straight so that we look nothing like them,
Yeah.
But that's just in a humorous way. But truthfully, they had this very humanist, or I don't know that I would call it humanist, but an approach which was not particularly based on a religion. Mm-hmm. It was strong culture, and I think they respected the inner explanation of what went on then, the Hasidic interpretation, if you will, is that they actually did respect Jewish cultures. They respected the cultural aspects of Judaism, but they did not want it to be a religion. They didn't want it to be based on a belief in something higher. Mm. You can do all these things, they're beautiful. Eat matzo balls, keep things like the Sabbath, but they didn't like the God part of it. They didn't like the part of it that said that this was part of a belief system and something higher, and you're doing it for a purpose that's beyond yourself, more than just cultural appreciation, if you will. Mm-hmm. And so I don't think they were coming from a religious perspective altogether. They weren't forcing the religion. There were other times in history where the Jews were persecuted by a group of people who were forcing a religion. In this case, they were not forcing a religion more than they did not want the Jewish religion. Mm-hmm. And they wanted a more secular way of life, and they wanted to be united. They didn't want a group of people within their kingdom to be living in a different way. Mm-hmm. And so they did whatever they could was in their power to really eliminate the Jewish religion. And to a large extent, they could have, you know, most people don't fight. Eventually, they kind of, you know, whether it was truthfully and sincerely or just kind of in order not to have trouble from the reigning government, they went along with that. There was, however, a group of people, a ragtag group of fighters, if you will, who got together under the banner of the Maccabees. The word Maccabee actually stands for the Hebrew words "Mi Hamroch HaBeidim Hashem," which was like a rallying cry, whoever is for God, come with me. And what they were essentially prepared to do was fight to the death for what they believed in. They wanted to protect their temple, they wanted to protect their religion, they wanted to retain their identity as Jews and the ability to keep their religion, celebrate the way they knew how, and that was who they were. Mm-hmm. So there were a number of situations which essentially led to a victory for the Maccabees. It was progressively more, on a military level, they progressed more and more. They sent a group of people to the area called, in Israel, called Modin, which was a stronghold of the Maccabees. And they set up, you know, an altar in the center of town, and they brought idols and things which were obviously foreign to Jewish religion, and they attempted to bring all people together and kind of, you know, make an official official announcement or procession that would have officially introduced this new way of life into their area. And that led to a showdown right then and there between the Maccabees and the Syrian Greek army. And in fact, one of the Greek officers or generals got killed. And this enraged Antiochus. He sent a greater number of people to go and force them to give up their Judaism and to convert or to drop the Judaism, and that failed as well. This group of people were determined, they were very determined, and although they did not have a military advantage at all, not in numbers, not in equipment, and not in, you know, the horses, elephants, whatever they used in those days is, you know, the sign of strength and power. Eventually, they sent an army of 40,000 to take out these Maccabees. They sent an army of 40,000 people to take out the Maccabees, and they did not succeed. There was a, listen, you're talking about a group of maybe a few hundred people.
That's insane.
And they all went running for the hills eventually. A lot of them died, and this was the victory of, the story of the victory of the few over the many, which is famously documented and spoken about with regards to Hanukkah. That was major miracle number one, and there are obviously many, many miracles that took place during the story of Hanukkah. But that was miracle number one, the victory of the few over the many, and those who were, I guess you could call them a minority in today's terms, but they were determined. They understood that they're fighting for something which is higher than themselves and prepared to potentially die for it. And miraculously, they were victorious, and they went to the temple. The temple then was in shambles, essentially, because since it was such an important place for the Jewish people, the Syrian Greek army had chosen to desecrate it specifically. One could say as like a sign of, you know, victory, if you will, a icon or a symbol of disposing of the Jewish faith and taking something like the temple and turning it into a place for paganism or so they came back to this temple, and suddenly they see the place is all in shambles. They go about the business of cleaning it up and trying to fix up whatever is possible, removing all the foreign objects that didn't belong there and trying to restore the place and get it back up and running so that they could do the daily services. In that process, they came across the menorah. The menorah was a service done at the temple every day, and it requires pure olive oil created or pressed in a specific way. takes a while to do it because they needed to travel to a certain area in Israel where the olives were particularly ripe and very, very juicy. And they used to use the first drop of olive oil from each olive, and the rest of it was used for something else. And this was extremely pure, very, very designated. And so it took time to make it. And the turnaround time was 8 days. And today we're all familiar with the idea of a supply chain shortage. Yeah. But then it was, you know, they didn't know what we're going to do. And should we light the menorah, even though we don't have enough to last for 8 days? And, or should we not light the menorah and maybe just wait until we have enough to keep it lit for, as you know, ongoing, which was the mitzvah, is to keep it lit as on an ongoing basis. Mm-hmm. So they decided we're going to light it.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see what happens from there. You know, we'll take it one step at a time, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
We did. And that's the second miracle that took place, is that the oil, which was enough for one night, mm-hmm. could fill up the cups of the menorah, which typically would have lasted a night or a day, night and a day. So a 24-hour period ended up lasting for 8 24-hour periods, which mm-hmm. is why Hanukkah is 8 days long, and which is why we use oil as a particular theme. Many people light the menorah with oil, some use candles.
Mm-hmm.
The foods that we eat are prepared with plenty of oil, mm-hmm. and oil has a lot of symbolism and a lot of meaning, which is something we talk about and celebrate throughout Hanukkah. So that's the story in a nutshell.
Mm-hmm. It makes sense. So I understand the origins of the menorah now. What is the lesson? Like, if you're instructing a young Jewish person on what they should be taking away from Hanukkah, what do you tell them it is? Is it celebrating the story of the Jewish people's survival?
So that's an interesting thing you bring up, because, yes, I would agree with that, that it is a story of the Jewish people's survival, but it doesn't make Hanukkah unique per se. You know, they say that the way you sum up every Jewish holiday is, they tried to kill us, we won, let's eat.
Yeah, yeah.
So that happened, unfortunately, many times throughout history. And so we are constantly celebrating the miracle of the Jewish survival. And that's true about Hanukkah as well. What's unique about Hanukkah, and really special, I think, is that it really has a universal message, several universal messages. Mm-hmm. It's not complicated. You don't need to be PhD to get and to understand lessons,
mm-hmm.
takeaways from the Hanukkah story. We can talk about a few of them, but really, there are so many. It's almost it's hard to cover all of them. But I mean, just starting from the story itself, we talk about people who were determined, had a belief, understood what they stood for, and were willing to fight for their tradition, not to assimilate, not to give into tyranny, and being forced to give up something that to them was our religion. It's the truth. It's the way we serve God. It's our relationship. It's who we are. You know, that is true about everybody. It's true about anybody. Somebody who recognize what's higher and stick to their principles, even when they're in the minority, and even when it seems like there isn't really a lot of hope. This is an inspiration, you know, and if you can tell somebody today that what does it mean to be a modern-day Maccabee, I mean, you can draw your own conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
A Maccabee is somebody who fights for the truth, fights for what's right, fights in spite of the fact that it may not be popular, fights in spite of the fact that it may seem somewhat hopeless, and they would be relying on a miracle, essentially, to move forward. But all of those calculations are things that one would put aside when they truly and passionately believe something.
Mm-hmm.
The victory of that ability of freedom of religion, of freedom to serve, worship, and follow your religion, serve God in the way that we know. This is a message of Hanukkah. And the menorah really has become a symbol of that, a symbol of freedom, mm-hmm. a symbol of light. You know, there are many places in the world, and each of us have this in our own life as well. Places that are dark,
mm-hmm.
and oppressed, places that are difficult for us. And it could be, again, it could be in your personal life, and the message of light. The menorah is light, it's warmth, it's fire. And there's just a lot in that. That when you light a light, the famous saying is, a little bit of light pushes away a lot of darkness. Hmm. And just on a scientific level, darkness is an absence of light.
Mm-hmm.
And so many people think today's day and age, we're oftentimes reaching a fever pitch or climbing up the stairs with each other to attain what we want to consider dispelling darkness, dispelling difficulty. And it just could be in so many areas of our life, and or with our own, facing our own issues, facing our own challenges. And oftentimes we think that fighting that darkness is the way to go. You know, just fight the darkness. And sometimes you just need to take a step back and realize that introducing light, focusing on the positive, focusing on that which is good, and really trying to help that spread and give it a platform, a big platform if possible. As you'll see all over town, there's big menorahs out there. There are menorahs on trucks. There are menorahs the sides of the highway, in the mall, just on the sidewalk. Many places you go, because what we're trying to say is we're giving a platform to this miracle because it has this universal appeal, because this message is so powerful and so strong that this light exists. It needs to be given a platform.
Mm-hmm.
And when you do, the darkness just disappears and dissipates all of itself. What seemed before to be an insurmountable challenge is now you shine a light and it's put into perspective right there. So,
mm-hmm.
And then again, of course, the menorah progressively, we light, you know, the first night we light one light, second light, night two, and then progressively add one
mm-hmm.
until the whole menorah is lit. And there again, you have this lesson, which I think each of us, whether you're Jewish or you're not, can relate to, and that is that adding in light, what was good yesterday may not be enough for today. Our challenges become greater and our potential is greater. And mm-hmm. so to light one light every night of Hanukkah, that's cute and that's nice, but that's not the way we celebrate this holiday and our tradition, and our tradition is specifically to add in light. And that's mm-hmm. a message for everybody that adding in light is the way that we accomplish this. And one can say that was maybe the strength of the Maccabees, is they recognized where that light was and they stayed focused on it. They kept their eyes on the prize and they didn't allow the darkness around them to pull them down and to make it hopeless.
Mm.
And so each of us in our lives can be that light into the space around us as well. So it's a personal thing, but it's, you can be this to others, and you can do it through kindness. You can do it through being a moral person, acts of morality and kindness to others, reaching out to others, especially now. You know, our world is way different than we've envisioned it maybe 2-3 years ago. And there's ever more need for reaching out to one another and helping one another and rising above our differences. You know, mm-hmm. the menorah has 8 branches. 8 branches can represent 8 different type of people, but when they come together and you realize, you look down a little bit deeper, you realize that at the stem, it's one. It's all coming from the same, and God created us different, and we branch out in different directions, but we're all part of one. And so one branch can help another branch, even though we're different branches. And you got a left side of the menorah, and the right side of the menorah, and the top of the menorah, and this side. We're all part of one, and we have to recognize that deeper down. We are here for each other. We have to be here for each other. And one light, a light for one is a light for 100. It doesn't cost extra money to light extra lights.
Mm-hmm.
You can light your candle from my light and I lose nothing.
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
the nature of light. And so it's such a bright, light, warm holiday that its appeal is way beyond just the preservation of the Jewish people,
mm-hmm.
although that is at the core of it. And if you want to define what light is, it is the ability for people to follow and, you know, their way of life, serve God, serve a higher purpose, to spread kindness around them, and to be light.
You make a very good point about the nature of darkness, because if you're just a person stumbling around in the darkness, it's almost impossible to vanquish it. You know, you're feeling around, you're not really sure what to do, but if you sort of modify your own human experience by adding a little bit of light, the light effortlessly defeats the darkness, and it's incredibly easy. And I think it's a very pertinent message to people, you know, Jewish or not, on all sides of the political spectrum these days, that, you know, they need to become a Maccabee, like you said, be somebody that, instead of focusing on the difficulty of that fight and the impossibility of the task, you focus on what you're fighting for, and you bring the light into the situation. It's a very inspiring, very broad message. It seems like it would have a lot of appeal to a lot of different people outside just Judaism.
Yeah, absolutely. And it goes further than that, of course, and that is that today, you know, from many different perspectives, people talk about how the world is, you know, kind of reaching points where it never reached before.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever your belief is, whatever your credo is, whatever your convictions are, people oftentimes are losing hope. Losing hope in the world, losing hope in humanity, losing hope in so many different ways. And that is another message of Hanukkah, and maybe from the Maccabees, is not to lose hope. And the fact that miracles do happen, they happen around us. Your eyes have to be open to see them, because, you know, if you have a high expectation and you're entitled, you may not realize that a miracle happened. But miracles are happening all around us, and sometimes they come in a fashion which is enclosed in natural means, in a natural way, whether it's a modern medicine, whether it's science, whether it's the advancement of better values around the world in ways which, like you said, you know, without a shot fired, by shining light. So something that the Lubavitcher Rebbe, Rabbi Menachem Schneerson of blessed memory, who is one of the most influential religious personalities of the modern history, the rabbi, the Rebbe of Chabad Lubavitch, taught many things, and many of the teachings that I'm talking to you about today are called from his teachings. But one of the things that I think are key, and specifically him coming after the time of the Holocaust, where so many, about a third of the Jewish population of the world was decimated, and you're talking about Jewish survival, the Rebbe's approach was highly positive, very, very, what they call maybe a positivity bias, which was his willingness and interest to focus on that which is good. And he taught that the world is a garden. The world could sometimes seem like a jungle, which is, it just doesn't seem to be law and order. It's just falling apart. We don't know who's what, what's up and what's down. But in reality, the world is a garden. And not only that, we human beings are the gardeners. We're the ones who are tasked with keeping it up. And not only keeping it up, but making it more beautiful over time. And if to you the world does not seem like a garden, I can see why that is, but that's where light comes in. Like you said before, when somebody's in the darkness, it's all there, but you don't know what's what. You don't know if it's a door or a window. You don't know if you're touching gold or some piece of trash. And what light does is it shines on everything, and suddenly everything becomes clear. Nothing is new. Didn't introduce anything new. It just made everything understood, apparent, and visible. And so really, it's a message perhaps about changing our world view and recognizing that our world is really a garden, a beautiful place where so many beautiful things are happening, but you have to stop to smell the flowers, to smell the roses, like they say. You have to recognize where that is, and if you don't recognize where it is, how are you going to strengthen those things? How are you going to know which side you're on when everything's just chaos? So light is a key to the future, is a key to where we're headed as a people, as a nation, as a human race, if you will.
I like the optimism. I mean, this message obviously has direct implications for all sorts of people. But one thing I'm left wondering is, what happens when you have two people with contradictory perceptions of light? What could be one person's light is another person's misinformation. You know, two different perspectives on truth might clash with each other, and people might have different ideas about which torch we should be carrying. How would you respond to those questions?
Right. Zoom out. If you live in a world of absolutes, it's going to be difficult for you. There is absolute right and wrong in the question. There's definitely absolute good and bad. But the human condition, humanity is a plethora of people going in different places on different journeys. And at different points in time, people believe different things. All of our convictions evolve, I hope. We become more knowledgeable. We become more, hopefully, enlightened. And, we become introduced to new things. And we have to be willing to adapt and understand others' perspectives. And respect is a huge thing. Is a very big thing. I think that, not to say that every single human being has only good at heart.
Yeah.
There are people out there who are definitely not out for the good. They have very bad motives, and that should not be ignored. Mm-hmm. But we don't have to assume the worst in people all the time just because they think differently than us and even diametrically opposed to what we are. And we have to recognize something also, and that is that if you truly believe what you stand for, or what you are holding the torch of, if you will, the best way to help another person understand your point of view and perhaps be won over to your way of thinking is by being respectful and by showing kindness, showing light, showing that you understand that another person may have a diametrically opposed view to yours, but you don't assume that they have that view because of a sinister reason or because of some other motive, other than that they too are trying to get to the truth. They too are trying to do what's best for others, and they believe something different than you because of, could be many reasons, many circumstances. The question is, if you want to be right or you want to be smart. If you want to be right, you maybe want to shun this person, lock him out of your life, call him all kinds of names, and go and smear them. But if you want to be smart, and we all need to be smart because our world needs smart people, and our world needs people who are dedicated and designated to spreading moral values and helping each other, like I said, now more than ever. So we need people who are smart and have the ability to work with each other. And we expect that all across the board. We expect it from religious leaders. We expect it from politicians. And we expect it from others. And the average person is tired of seeing people snipe at each other. And it's become, unfortunately, too common in today's discourse. But we can all take a step back. Like I said, if you, use this analogy of a camera. If you zoomed into the tops of the menorah, you'll realize they're all separate branches. But if you zoom out, you zoom out, you zoom out, and you zoom out, you'll realize that they all at the bottom are at the same stem. They come to the same core. They all, their energy, if it's an electric menorah, all stems from the bottom and comes through. And they branch out, of course. But don't forget, we're all grounded in the same reality. And that is something which we all need to remember, and that we're all children of God. We are all human beings. We are all here for a purpose, and hopefully share that purpose, which is to create a better world, to make the world a better place. We may have different routes to get there. We may have some different ideas of how that needs to happen, and sometimes they're even diametrically opposed to each other, but that's the area where hope needs to come in. And instead of falling prey to the easy part of us that says, If people could believe this, I don't know if I want to exist in such a world. Instead of getting wrapped around the axle that way, if we could each take a step back and say, that's okay, I don't agree with you at all. I in fact, absolutely disagree with you. But that's the beauty of it all. I can still be your friend. I can still talk to you. I can still focus on the things that we agree upon. And I have the distinct pleasure of seeing this all the time. Friendships between people who are the most what we've come to assume or think of as the most people you would not suspect have friendships. And that is because they've realized something about human beings, which is beyond, their agendas, which is that we're just all here together for the same purpose, which is to help our world, to help ourselves, to help our families become happier, better, more fulfilled, and like I said, to make the garden, that garden, a more beautiful place
One thing I notice about this philosophy that you've articulated is that it's relatively optimistic, and it seems a lot more, I don't want to use the word inclusive because that has so many political connotations, but it's an optimistic and peaceful philosophy. It would be very easy, I think, for the Jewish philosophy to become warlike and hardened, after all the different trials that the Jewish people have endured. Why do you think it is that that didn't happen?
That's a very good question. I never gave a ton of thought to that. I think Judaism is based on Torah. Torah comes from God, and that's the truth. So although it Jewish philosophy is definitely, as articulated by myself, so of course you're going to hear my kind of flavor in it, but essentially if the core values that we're talking about are the truth doesn't get diminished because human beings happen not to perpetrate them or execute them in the right way. Sorry for those two kind of harsh words, but
yeah,
meaning don't question the system, question the way it's being executed. The values are the right values, the morals are the right morals. Our willingness to believe in those morals, in spite of the fact that because of the fact that we've recognized and witnessed what happens when the world does not follow these morals. Take the most recent example. There are people that destroy the world all in the name of a credo, a belief system, which they are absolutely convinced of. But they're so convinced of it, and they become so extreme in it, that they've neglected the basic tenets of human values that have guided humanity throughout the generations. Things like the seven Noahide laws, the universal code that we understand to be above and beyond, higher than our particular agendas, our particular beliefs. So in some ways, if you were cynical, or you could become very discouraged and say, well, if this is a world where people could believe this and perpetrate this, I don't want to live there. And a person can't be blamed for that. For example, Holocaust survivor, having seen the worst in humanity, losing hope. I'm not a person who can judge that. They've seen the worst of the worst. And there are many, unfortunately, who have gone through such difficult things that in looking at it with, as objectively as one can, perhaps. And I have relatives who've perished in the Holocaust. My grandparents are Holocaust survivors, or were Holocaust survivors. They both passed now. But my grandmother was one of 11 children who survived in her family. And so it is personal. It's not like we were existing on another side of the world and untouched by a tragedy like this. But you come out of this and you realize that a world without morals, a world without a positive outlook, a world without a recognition that all these things are important could look like that. And that's the beauty of America, is that we are living in a time where, and with principles that are scream and shout, that is not the way. We do have morals, we do have values, and they need to be defended, no question. Human beings by nature are fallible. Our minds are biased to our hearts, what we want and what we think is right, or what we convince ourselves is right, and that's where we have to have the moral code, which does not allow us to fall back into places where humanity does not want to be or should not be. In short answers, perhaps in spite of, or perhaps because of, what we've witnessed, we're more convinced of this than ever.
That makes sense. I do see what you're saying. Is there anything else about the Hanukkah tradition or the lessons that can be derived from it that you feel that should be expressed but that I haven't asked about?
Yes. So first of all, so those who are celebrating Hanukkah, there still is a quite a bit of Hanukkah to go. We're just on the fourth day, so tonight will be the fifth night, and the lights should be lit. Each night, another light until the menorah is full, which will be on Sunday night. It's coming Sunday night, where the menorah will be completely full. Now, you could make a menorah out of a lot of different things. You could use olive oil with a wick. A wick could be made of cotton. Or you could use candles and really any receptacle. If you do want a menorah or candles, we'll be happy to provide it free of charge. You could text us, 612-208-7122. And you can also learn a lot more about Hanukkah in general at Hanukkah.org, which is a mega site. It's got all kinds of beautiful videos and stories, articles, inspiration of different sorts. We eat Hanukkah foods, donuts, latkes, things that are fried in oil, and that's the tradition of Hanukkah, and again, celebrating the miracle of oil. We do give Hanukkah geld, which is money to the children. It's kind of like a tradition of Hanukkah, which is done, and all of these things are important to celebrate and to actually do, not just, you know, to celebrate the spirit and what the story is about, but actual practice is important. You'll see all kinds of giant menorahs up around town. Those are there to spread this message and to help us celebrate together and in public. One of the big parts of Hanukkah is publicizing this miracle. And that's what we do. We don't want this light just to stay at home, although it starts there. We want to take it to the streets. We want everybody to know it. We want it to be available and inspire everybody in an increasing measure. We want it to go from day to day. Mm-hmm. And if you're okay with it, I actually wanted to read you an interesting letter from the rabbi.
For sure.
Which was written in 1981, but I will say, I believe, pertinent as ever. And I'm just trying to pull it up here. So this letter was written Hanukkah 5741, which is the Jewish count of the years, 1980. It reads like this. To all participants in the public lighting of the Hanukkah menorah in the USA, greeting and blessing. Hanukkah, the festival of lights, recalls the victory more than 2,100 years ago of a militarily weak but spiritually strong Jewish people over the mighty forces of a ruthless enemy that had overrun the Holy Land and threatened to engulf the land and its people in darkness. The miraculous victory, culminating with the rededication of the sanctuary in Jerusalem and the rekindling of the menorah, which had been desecrated and extinguished by the enemy, has been celebrated annually ever since during these 8 days of Hanukkah, especially by lighting the Hanukkah menorah. Also as a symbol and message of the triumph of freedom over oppression, of spirit over matter, of light over darkness. It is a timely and reassuring message, for the forces of darkness are ever present. Moreover, the danger does not come exclusively from outside, but often lurks close to home in the form of insidious erosion of time-honored values and principles that are at the foundation of any decent human society. Needless to say, darkness is not chased away by brooms and sticks, but by illumination. Our sages said, a little bit of light expels a lot of darkness. The Hanukkah lights remind us in the most obvious way that illumination begins at home, within oneself and one's family, by increasing and intensifying the light of Torah and mitzvahs into everyday experience, even as the Hanukkah lights are kindled in growing numbers from day to day. But though it begins at home, it does not stop there. Such is the nature of light that when one kindles a light for one's own benefit, it benefits also all who are in the vicinity. Indeed, the Hanukkah lights are expressly meant to illuminate the outside, symbolically alluding to the duty to bring light to also to those who, for one reason or another, still walk in darkness. What is true of the individual is true of the nation, especially this great United States, united under God and generously blessed by God with material as well as spiritual riches. It is surely the duty and privilege of this nation to promote all the forces of light, both at home and abroad, and in a steadily growing measure. Let us pray that the message of Hanukkah lights will illuminate the everyday life of everyone personally and of the society at large for a brighter life in every respect, both materially and spiritually. With esteem and blessing, the spirit of Hanukkah, Rabbi Schneerson.
Yeah, no, it rearticulates a lot of what you were saying about the importance and emphasis of light. And it really makes a lot more sense after talking with you why you have the menorah. I never understood the spiritual significance of that, and that the candle or the light or the olive light, whatever light-emitting device you use, why that's so important. I always assumed that the menorah was the symbol itself and that the lights were some sort of decoration or indicator of time passing. But you've illuminated, pun intended, its real purpose. I appreciate that.
It's my pleasure, and I hope that others can find some inspiration in that as well. And I'm sure we'll have more opportunities to talk about some of the things we touched upon today.